Let me take you back in time, to a place without the wonders of the modern world. 500 years ago, the earth was dark, a place of mystery and superstition. But then science changed everything. This series will tell the stories of the British scientists who changed the world. We have asked some of the great scientists and inventors of today to tell us about their heroes.
Now let's start her up. It opened up a whole new world of the very small.
Kate, was Thompson's big idea?
The moon hunter is a true hero.
Exciting possibility.
He made science in Britain really matter.
Britain has a tremendous scientific legacy that most people know little about. We want to set the record straight and put science back on the map.
The world is full of wonders, but they become more wonderful when science looks at them.
In the winter of 1664, a strange star appeared in the night skies above Britain. At a time when witches were still burned at the stake, and people believed centaurs roamed the forest, this comet seemed to most a harbinger of doom. But five young men looked up at it, and dared to ask questions. This is the story of how these extraordinary men, friends and rivals, would each play a pivotal part in understanding the comet. Between them, they would begin to unlock the secrets of the universe, and summon science into being.
For me, the story begins with just one of these young men. In 1664, he looked up from his studies in Oxford and saw the comet. And it took his breath away. He was a brilliant mathematician and inventor, and his name was Christopher Wren.
Today we know him as an architect for the magnificent buildings he put up in London, St Paul's Cathedral, Hampton Court, and for this, the Sheldonian Theatre in Oxford.
Wren's early life was one of privilege and ease. He was a playmate of the young Prince Charles, who, after much bloodshed and the Civil War, would go on to become king.
The Civil War had turned Wren's life upside down. And it left Wren with a desperate yearning for certainty, stability, and truth.
And it was his thirst for discovery that was about to provide him with just that. Wren was invited to join a little-known society. It was known informally as the Invisible College. With only 12 members, this passionate group of experimental philosophers had a burning desire to understand the natural world through reason, logic, and experiment. They met every week, conducting ever more ambitious experiments.
Oxford was still reeling in the aftermath of the Civil War. And this presented scientists with a gruesome opportunity.
human corpses were in ready supply. So Wren and his friends were able to investigate human anatomy firsthand. And Wren himself was a superb draftsman and produced drawings like this, one of the first detailed drawings of the human brain. But Wren wanted to know more. He wanted to understand not just form, but function. A commonly held belief was that the spleen was as vital to life as the brain. Wren wondered if this could possibly be true. On one occasion, Wren took a spaniel like this and tied the poor thing down on a table on its back. And then Wren, in his own words, took a knife, thrust it into the abdomen, pierced the muscles, and ripped about. He then put in two fingers, pulled out the spleen, and cut it away, tied up the blood vessels and the wound, and let the dog go. Barbaric? Certainly. Pointless? Not at all. By demonstrating that the dog could live perfectly well without its spleen, he established the notion that superstitions could be dealt with by practical experiment, and that way you would discover the truth about the world around us. Like most scientists of his time, Christopher Wren was a polymath. He was interested in everything, from the movements of the moon to the behavior of bees. He had an insatiable curiosity. In this portrait of him in the Sheldonian, you can see him surrounded by some of the subjects of his interest. A globe, the moon, a telescope. Long before he turned to architecture, Wren was tantalized by the heavens and what he called the celestial mysteries. But he had a problem. Telescopes of the time had huge limitations. If he wanted to explore this uncharted world, he would have to go back to basics. So what did he do? He dissected the eye of a horse to see how a lens worked in nature. And it's this combination of anatomist and astronomer and technician that lies at the very heart of Wren's brilliance. Using what he had learned from the horse's eye and other experiments and observations, Wren was able to calibrate his telescope so finely that he succeeded in gaining a clear view of the moon's surface. An astounding new world began to appear before his eyes.
In 1660, the Invisible College set up headquarters in the city of London. With the backing of Wren's old playmate, the new King Charles, they transformed themselves into the Royal Society. Their motto was, Nullius in Verba. Take nobody's word for it. This small band of brilliant young men had begun a revolution.